Stand by. We are now entering the atmosphere of Venus. Attention!
Before the first space programs of the 20th century, it was thought that our closest neighboring planet may harbor life.
I can remember their images where there are dinosaurs and flying dinosaurs.
Thick clouds covering the surface of Venus caused humanity's imagination to run wild. And for good reason.
So at first glance, Venus and Earth are quite similar. They are about the same size and about the same mass. And in fact, sometimes Venus is called our sister planet.
But the first probes sent by the Soviet Union and NASA discovered a world plagued with a poisonous greenhouse atmosphere, a sweltering surface temperature, and a crushing air pressure.
The Venusian surface has a temperature of over 450 degrees Celsius, so lead essentially melts on the surface of Venus. It's very hostile.
And so attention turned to our more hospitable neighbor, Mars, leaving Venus largely neglected for decades, but never forgotten. Scientists long speculated that microbial life could exist in the permanent cloud layer atmosphere.
It turns out that in the upper layers of the atmosphere, between 50 to 60 kilometers above the surface, we found conditions which are not that different from the surface condition we find on Earth.
Then in 2020, evidence of biomarkers, potential signs of life, were detected in that cloud layer.
Maybe the case is that microbial life has adapted, has evolved in order to survive in the high clouds of Venus.
And although the claim was later disputed, it reinvigorated an enthusiasm for Venus. And scientists are proposing multiple missions with a single objective.
We can just pick one thing and go for it. And we can also work on the taboo topic of the search for life.
The Soviet Union's Venus missions gave us the first landings and images of the surface of another planet, the first audio recordings from the surface of another planet, and the first, and so far the only, planetary balloon missions.
Balloons have already been flown in the Venusian atmosphere, the Vega 1 and 2 balloons, so we know it works.
In 1985, the two spacecraft, called Vega 1 and Vega 2, arrived at Venus, both equipped with landers and balloons to explore the cloud layer atmosphere. The balloons separated from the crafts, lasting more than 46 hours while taking measurements. The data from that upper cloud layer differed greatly from the hellish surface.
So the winds have speeds of about 350 or 360 kilometers per hour. That's about the speed of a bullet train and corresponds to the fastest winds we have ever measured on Earth. If we only look at temperature and pressure, the conditions are very similar to the surface conditions on Earth. However, the clouds, which on Earth consist of water vapor, they're actually made of sulfuric acid. So we are looking for life which can survive in an extreme environment.
The cloud layer is estimated to be 50 to 100 times drier than the driest place on Earth, the Atacama Desert in Chile. Dr. Armando Azuabustos, an astrobiologist and Atacama native, has spent much of his career looking at whether life can exist in extreme environments.
We thought at the first we would not find any because it was so dry that there's not any evidence of water here. But if you go like 30 centimeters down the soil, 50 centimeters down, something like this, right? We found a number of microorganisms which were wondering how they're able to make it there.
These organisms are called extremophiles, life that is adapted to survive in harsh environments, like a desert with no known water source.
The Atacama is even as dry and as old as a desert as it is, you can still find life even in those areas, telling you that it seems that there's no limit for life on Earth. And even in the hardest of this environment, you find life. So if that is possible here, how couldn't that be the same case in other planets?
The near-sterile environment of the Atacama is normally used as a testing bed for finding life on Mars. but the clouds here could give us clues about life on Venus, too.
By inspecting the habitability of those clouds, this is just something we're doing now, as we speak. We're trying to understand how that can also be proposed as an analog model of the habitabilities of the high clouds of Venusian atmosphere.
But the Venusian atmosphere isn't just dry, it's extremely acidic. The cave of the lighted house in Mexico contains toxic amounts of sulfuric acid. Yet microbial life has evolved to use other chemical processes to obtain energy other than photosynthesis.
We already have a sample that life was able to evolve and adapt to the most acidic environment on Earth. And you cannot measure a pH lower than zero. It cannot get more acidic than that. So if life was able to adapt to that environment, why could not be the case if life ever arose on Venus? Why is it important to try and understand the limits of life on Earth, and how do we inspect the so-called extreme environment on Earth? Because that gives you an idea on what you may expect, on how you should look for life elsewhere. So it's not easy, it's not cheap to go to Mars, for example, but I can go to the Atacama Desert, which is a good analog model.
While we've been learning a lot about extremophiles on Earth, we've also continued to learn more about Venus since those early missions.
Now, in terms of knowledge of Venus, today we know much more about Venus, such as about the existing of prebiotic components such as ammonia and hydrogen cyanide. We also know that the greenhouse effect on Venus started about 1 billion years ago. So we know a lot more things about Venus thanks to many missions which went to Venus, such as orbiter missions in the past decades.
Very small amounts of oxygen were detected in the atmosphere by at least two different separate independent probes. And it's amazing because we also don't know how oxygen would be made on Venus at the levels found. And there's sort of enough puzzles that something really interesting is happening on Venus.
Recent probes to Venus, like the European Space Agency's Venus Express and the Japanese Aerospace Exploration Agency's Akatsuki, has given us a lot of valuable science. But only Mars has had missions specifically looking for organic compounds, the ingredients for life. Then in 2020, this happened.
It's an extraordinary possibility, living organisms floating in the clouds of planet Venus.
There may be some form of life on Venus.
This gas is called phosphite. Now, what exactly is it? Do we have any idea?
A team, led by astronomers in the UK, reported seeing the spectral signature of phosphine in telescope data.
Phosphine is very unusual because on Earth, it's only associated with life. Either bacteria in oxygen-free environments like wetlands, or made by humans as pesticides and other chemicals.
Suddenly, there was a potential biomarker for life in the Venusian atmosphere, and this really changed a little bit the picture of astrobiology research in our solar system.
While some groups have disputed the claim, saying that the phosphine signal isn't there, or at least at levels less than previously thought, it's reinvigorated the interest in Venus from the public and scientific community.
So, despite all this controversy of phosphine, people have started to relook at the old so-called legacy data from the American and Russian probes that went into the Venus atmosphere in the late 70s and early 80s. And what's very intriguing is it looks like there's evidence for phosphine from that old data.
One thing everyone can agree on is the need for more research into Venus. NASA and the European Space Agency recently greenlit three separate missions. Veritas will map the planet's surface, and DaVinci Plus, the second NASA mission, will have an orbiter to image Venus in the ultraviolet and infrared light, and will send a probe through Venus's atmosphere. While the European Space Agency's Envision will take high-resolution radar images of the planet's surface. Although these missions will give us a lot of valuable data, none of them are dedicated solely to finding biomarkers.
In order to really determine whether there is life, we would need to go there. And for us, the question was immediately, how can we quickly develop and launch a mission in order to determine whether there's really life in the Venusian atmosphere or not. And within 2 weeks after the announcement of the potential discovery of phosphine, we published a report on this mission study to deploy a fleet of balloons in the Venusian atmosphere and to search for life.
Balloons are used for scientific studies on Earth due to their cheap cost, simple design, and ability to stay in the atmosphere for a long period of time.
You can buy high-altitude balloons for maybe a couple of hundred dollars or euros. They tend to be fairly robust, so you just launch them and then you can essentially forget about them. And these are two benefits which are also applicable to the Venusian context.
And considering the technology already exists, it could be launched quickly.
Venusian balloon, which consists essentially of two basic elements. So one is the balloon sphere, and then we have what we call a chipset. So it's about the size of a credit card, and we have a very small payload, such as a tiny camera or a small microscope on board, and all the subsystems, such as power supply and communications, etc.
So far, this proposal hasn't made it to the hardware phase yet, but a separate study, headed by Professor Sarah Seeger at MIT and funded in part by Breakthrough Initiatives, is looking at three separate missions, the first one to launch via Rocket Lab's rocket as early as 2023.
We're really, really absolutely thrilled that we have a mission to Venus. We've partnered with Rocket Lab to supply the scientists, science team, and science instrument. And there's room for like a tiny instrument, less than 1 kilogram, that will go on the probe. And the probe is going to drop through the atmosphere very quickly. So the probe would last maybe an hour. And going through the cloud layers that we care about, that will be about 3 minutes. So this mission is short. And the instrument that the team chose, it has a kind of complicated name. It's called an autofluorescing Nephelometer.
Autofluorescence refers to the fact that we're basically shining ultraviolet light on the droplets and looking for any fluorescence that in other wavelengths, other colors of light. And then nephelometer is just a fancy word for an instrument that measures the light that's scattered from particles. If you have a black light and you're out in the desert and you shine it on a scorpion, the scorpion lights up green colored, just like my piece of fluorescent plastic, and that demonstrates how organic compounds, life compounds, could be found on Venus with fluorescence.
The instrument, which in its final form will fit inside of an estimated 0.5 kg payload, will be the first attempt on Venus to specifically look for biomarkers.
This instrument by itself is not going to be able to definitively determine that there's life on Venus. But if we detect organic compounds in the cloud droplets, it's an indication that there might be life.
If what they find looks promising, their next mission would be a balloon mission to look for biomarkers in different areas of the atmosphere.
We envision a balloon, and we have a few very, very specific things we want to measure. We'd like to remeasure the gases that don't belong, including phosphine and ammonia and oxygen. We'd like to check out these droplets in more detail. In particular, we want to measure the acidity of the droplets, because there's some new theories out there, including one from my team, that the droplets aren't all uniform and that they're not all incredibly acidic, that some might be a more friendly acidity to life. And we'd also like to measure more details about the composition of the droplets, measure that directly, not just from light scattering.
And if there are promising discoveries from that mission, to ultimately prove microbes are present, they're proposing a third mission.
We would go to Venus with a balloon. And this balloon would have a miniature rocket attached to it. And we would collect samples. So we'd condense the cloud particles and we would trap some air on Venus, some of the gases. And we would package those, get it inside the rocket, which would launch from the balloon. And it would intercept with an orbiter that would then be able to act as a cruise vehicle to come home to Earth with these precious samples. So that here on Earth, we could use our very sophisticated and exquisite instruments to look for life.
these missions would be the first balloon missions to look for life on another planet, but probably not the last.
There are people who have been trying to get a balloon mission to Venus for decades, actually. It's not like we came and had all these brilliant ideas. We're obviously standing on the shoulders of people before us, you know, people who are still working on such missions.
But with the rise of private space companies and the miniaturization of technology, inexpensive balloon missions like these could solve mysteries faster and make space more accessible.
There's a basic human urge to find out if we are alone, but it's also of tremendous importance if we think about if we would find life on Venus, did it have the same origin as life on Earth, or did it really emerge in parallel? And this has huge implications also for us as humanity.
Every society in human history appears to have had astronomy as part of its culture. And that is about wanting to know and explore what is beyond Earth. And today that question, you know, includes, is there life out there? I think it's part of wanting to understand, you know, our place in the universe. Are we alone? Are we unique? Or is the universe filled with other life forms?